Hello, hello Ansari. First, I'll be introducing myself. I am Ekant Chawla. I've been in the IT industry for past 4 years now. And you can now start asking your doubts, queries in the chat. Okay. Okay, so we are facing, so Pooja is facing issues with MongoDB installations. Okay, Pooja, may I know which operating system you are using? Is it OS, is it Windows or Ubuntu? No, Saad, we will be, okay, Ubuntu. So what I would recommend is, that you go to MongoDB website and on the website you will see that in the installation section they have given the tutorial for Ubuntu on how to installing it. There are commands listed there. What I can do is I can share you the link for installation and then we can discuss it. Okay, so what is not working? Is it the command mongo or is it the command mongod which you are unable to run? If the installation is complete, how do you know it's not working? It runs sometime. Okay, so I'll first. Not on restarting. See, what happens is if you're running MongoDB or in one of your, say, command prompts, in one of your terminals, then it will be taking that port to the default port 27017. So if you try to run the same command in another terminal, that port is already occupied. It will not allow you to run the same application in the same port again. So please make sure that no run, current instance is running on the same port. So I would really suggest that you make sure of this point, and not in just MongoDB, but in any application, if a port is already occupied by some other process, you will not be able to use it in the new process. So what you can do is, you can change the port by using the command while you are launching the MongoD, and that command simply requires you to add the port flag --port. What I would suggest that you take the screenshot of the error that you get when you run MongoD and you send that screenshot to the support team, or you raise a ticket, and then it will be much easier to find what is causing the error. Because when you run the command MongoD, it will give you some error. Okay, let's move on to Nosad's jQuery AJAX callback function. First, I think you should know that what a callback do. Well, basically what happens is, say you want to do something, but you don't want to execute it right now. You want to execute it after some time when certain conditions are fulfilled. In that case, you give a callback function. Most of the time, you will have to give callback function in JavaScript because JavaScript is asynchronous in nature. That is why you will find that there are a lot of places where you have to give a callback function. Now, in case of Ajax, what Ajax is used for is for network calls. We use it to call backend APIs in your front end. What we need is that when that backend API is hit, on its response, based on what the response is, whether it was successful, whether it failed, we give different callbacks. When you go through the jQuery documentation, you will find that there are various callbacks that it takes, such as complete, fail, success, before, send, and all that. These callbacks are given to you so that you can provide functions written by you which should be executed when that event occurs. For example, before sending your request, you want to show a loader to the user. What you do is, in your Ajax call, in the before send callback, you give it a function where you are setting your loader. And on the success callback, you can remove that loader and you can process the desired logic that you have. Is that clear, Nosad? Okay, great. Now we'll be moving to Pankaj's question. Hi, sir. Why do we need to? Okay, Nosad, I'll tell you something about the equal to signs. There are two ways for comparison, right? One is double equal to and one is triple equal to. The difference between the two is, as you know, JavaScript does not have strict typing, which is when you declare a variable, you do not tell it whether it will be an integer, a string, a boolean, a floating number. There are no such declarations. You simply write let some variable name equal to some value. Because of this, when you compare two variables, in that case, if you use double equal to, what JavaScript will do is it will convert one of them so that the type is same for both. For example, if you are comparing a number 5 to a string which has 5, in that case, the integer 5 will be converted to a string. And then it will be compared. This will happen when you use double equal to. But in case of triple equal to, JavaScript does not do this conversion. It directly compares them. So if you do number 5, triple equal to string 5, it will return false. But if you use double equal to instead, it will return true. So that's the comparison. The main reason we use triple equal to is it saves computation. Because of it, JavaScript will take less computational time for comparison and our code will run faster. So mostly we use triple equal to. But if there's a situation where you know that one of them will be a string, the other will be a number, or one of them will be a string and the other will be, say, a boolean, then you can use double equal to, at the cost of obviously computational power, speed. So can I have the next question? If no, if you will compare an integer to zero, it will not show you a warning. You can compare that something is equal, triple equal to zero. what it shows a warning for, maybe it can be division by zero, but never comparison to zero, because there are a lot of cases where a lot of people have to compare with zeros. Okay, you got a warning during assignment. See, in the assignments, the warnings are basically due to many reasons. Maybe you are not syntactically correct, or your logic is incorrect. Sometimes what happens is students use console log, student use alert in the assignment. That interferes with our testing. What we do is we take the code that you submit and we test it on our servers. But if you use console log or alert, it fails to do that. It interferes with our testing, and because of that, you might be getting logical errors. Okay, Nosad has asked, what is asynchronous in jQuery AJAX? See, asynchronous is something that is not just related to AJAX, but JavaScript in general. What asynchronous means is, first, you will have to understand what synchronous means. When we write some code, what happens is it is executed from line one, then next line two, then line three, and one by one. We cannot jump between the lines unless there is a if condition or something like that. But usually it goes in a sequential order. And let us say you have a function call. You called some function. First, its execution must complete, and then next line will be executed. This type of programming is called synchronous programming. Java and other languages such as C, C++, they are synchronous in nature. What you called first will be executed first. And when once it is executed, then only the code will move to the next line. Your interpreter, your code execution will move to the next line only if previous line is executed and completed. What happens in asynchronous programming is we call a function, it does some program, it executes some code, and at some point it might happen that we want to wait for certain thing. Maybe you have given an API call in case of AJAX, but you don't want your entire application to freeze. You can test it. If you do not do it in a synchronous way, what will happen is your whole front end will freeze. Nothing will work because your JavaScript is stuck. We don't want that to happen. So what we do is we use the asynchronous architecture in JavaScript. What happens is that call is pushed onto an stack. That stack is maintained by JavaScript, and the code keeps continuing executing the lines after it. It does not wait for it to complete. Instead, it will be waiting in the stack. And when that event occurs, maybe the success event or the failure event in the Java's AJAX request occurs, in that case, that event will be executed. Whatever asynchronous code you have pushed on that event will be executed. That is what happens in asynchronous programming. You don't see this happening because it happens quite fast. Excuse me. But that is how it works. Is that clear, or do you want me to explain it? Okay, so I'll give you an example. Let us say you are executing a code, you are setting some objects, and then you are calling your API. You are setting some variables. Yes, yes, Pooja, you can send that screenshot of the terminal. So, So let us say you have a code written in which you are declaring some variables, you are taking some user inputs, and after that you are calling an API. what will happen if is that when you do that AJAX call, the callback functions that you have given, they are pushed onto the stack. JavaScript maintains a stack of functions which it currently is executing and which it will be executing later. There are two stacks. So what happens is the current stack has your current AJAX call. It sends that network call and then it pushes the callback functions into its event stack. What happens is then it continues through your code, and there, if there is nothing more to do, the thread waits idly. Now it's waiting. When it gets the response, that callback function that was present in the event stack is now pushed into the main execution pipeline. Now that callback function is executed just like a normal function would. The difference here would be that your main thread, because JavaScript is single threaded by nature, that main thread is not blocked. And so your application can keep running and it can take inputs on the user while it is waiting for the response to come from the API. This is also used in a lot of other ways when you are reading files. I don't know if you have reached the level for a node or if you are enrolled into the backend course, but even in case we are reading files, we are not stopping the main thread. What we do is we give it a callback that once you have read the file, you may call this function. That is how callbacks work. Basically, you assign a certain task to some of the JavaScript and you tell it when you are done with this task, you can go ahead and call this function. I don't want you to wait. That is how you can understand asynchronous programming as a real life example. Another example could be when you are adding click actions and when you are adding submit actions to your forms in HTML. What we are basically doing is that in case of that event, that click event occurring, you want something to be executed, but that execution does not happen instantaneously. When that click event occurs, that callback is again pushed into the event stack. And if JavaScript runs out of its current execution stack, it pulls the next task from the event stack. Okay, so I don't see any more questions. Was it clear, Nozad, that how asynchronous programming is used to, you know, keep the single thread running without blocking it, and what callback does? Okay, if you have any other query, or if you want me to explain a particular part that you are having trouble with, you can write it in the chat. If you guys don't have a query, maybe you might have a particular topic excuse me, that you might want to be explained. Okay, so Pooja has asked me to explain middlewares. Okay, so Pooja, first you should understand that when a request comes to a server, it goes through a lot of processing. We might have to first parse that request, because that request may be coming in different formats. It might be a JSON request, it might be URL encoded. As you might have seen that in the course, we are using URL encoded parsing. We are trying to parse. We are trying to parse the request. Yes, we use body parser for parsing the JSON in the body. But before that, we are also using URL encoded parser. So these parsers are used so that your request, incoming request, is in a processable form. All these parsers are middlewares. What do we mean by now middleware? A middleware is something that is in between your request, actual request, and in between your final controller function. Before I try to process your actual request, there may be a lot of things that I might have to do. Maybe I have to parse your incoming request. Maybe I have to check whether you are even allowed to make this request. Maybe I might want to decode your token and then add the user details into the request. All this part has to be done before I actually process your request, which is in the final controller function. Yeah, authenticated or not, authorized or not, these are two different. If a user has to pass his login details again and again in an API, that is not good. So in replacement of that, instead of passing user IDs and passwords or emails and password again and again, we use JWT tokens, right? That is used for authentication. So that we have to write in a middleware. So we can extract that JWT token, we can decode it, and then we can set the user details in the request itself, so that when it reaches the controller, final controller function, it has all that information. So all this, you are using maybe course prevention, you have course errors, right? Maybe we are adding some course error prevention middlewares, which we have written in the middleware. You might remember that in the code that we have shown in the tutorials, Aditya sir has told you that you have to add certain things to the request, such as allowed origins, such as allowed methods, and all that. So that is also part of, that is also a middleware. So anything that you do before you finally execute the controller on your request, anything between that and the actual request coming, is a middleware. Please explain socket. Okay. So you see, in a normal API call that we have, the HTTP calls, what we do is we make a call to the server, and then the server returns the response. The connection that is made with the server for this API call and for the response is temporary. Right after the request is completed, that connection is closed, in HTTP 1 at least. So what would you do in case if you want a continuous connection between you and the client, or the server and the client? In that case, we use socket connections. That is, we will create a permanent connection between the server and the client so that we can communicate in real time. That is what the socket.io package helps us with. It will allow you to create a continuous persistent connection between the client and the server, and the client and the server can communicate with each other through this socket by emitting events and listening to those events. As you might have seen that in the curriculum, we have created a server-side socket server, and on the client side, we are making the connection, we are verifying the user, and on the server side, once the user is verified, we set the user details, and then we inform the client. And in the chat application part, where when one user is typing, we emit the typing event from the client to the server, and the server will emit that event to other clients so that everyone knows that you are typing. So socket is basically helpful when you want real-time communication. For real-time communication, we need a persistent connection, and that is where socket comes in. Now, how socket informs the client and how client informs the socket is through events, JavaScript events. Is there anything more that you want when client needs? Well, client, in any case where there is no real-time application, client will not need a continuous connection. Real-time application include maybe you want to inform the user when that event actually happens. What it means by real-time? Real-time means, let us say I am sitting here and you are sitting at your home, most likely. So in that case, you want whatever I am speaking right now to be sent to you immediately, like just right now, not 5 minutes later, not 10 minutes later, right now. So that is real time. Let us say you want to see the WhatsApp chat messages. If someone sends you a message, you want that message right now. That is real time. Whatever is happening in our timeline at a continuous pace, that is okay. So what is lexical binding? Nosad, if you would have studied compiler in your engineering, or if you've had a computer science background, then if at any point of time you had studied compilers, you will know that the code that we write goes through a lot of stages. It is analyzed for syntax, the variables are allotted memory. There's a lot of things. One of them in the early steps is lexical binding. So in that step, what happens is the context is decided for all the variables. In layman term, you can say that we get to know who is talking about what this line is talking about. Most likely you are talking about lexical binding because you want to know how this keyword works. Am I right? You want to know how lexical binding and the this keywords are interrelated, because okay, yes, I thought so. So you see, this refers to the object or the thing that we are talking about. Basically, we call it context in programming terms, that what are we working on? Because we cannot see the object right now. The object has maybe called a function that was attached to it, or maybe the function itself has some functions inside it and you are using the dot operator to access them. So what happens is things are related to each other. And when you're calling or executing some code, it is possible that you want to know who this code is related to. Maybe you are having a string object and you want to get the substring, the function substring, which takes the input parameters and gives you a part of the string. Maybe the starting part, maybe the ending part, the index that you give, it gives you a certain part of the string. Now, how do you know that which object you are referring to when you are executing that code? inside that substring function, that is referred to by using the this keyword. And lexical binding is basically telling the interpreter before executing what this keyword currently refers to. When we use arrow functions, a new lexical scope is not created, which means whatever this referred to before this function is what it refers to now inside this arrow function itself. Is the concept of the this keyword clear to you now? Okay, you want me to discuss for of loop. Okay, so first you should know what a for loop does, right? A for loop is basically used to go over an iterable object. That iterable can be an array, it can be a JSON object, a map, anything. Now what for of and foreign have been difference is that in foreign loop you get the index of the array you are iterating, or you get the key of the object you are iterating in the variable before in. But in case of for of, first of all you should know that the for of loop will only work for arrays. So the reason we want it is that not always we want the index of the item in the array. Sometimes we want the item itself. Let us say we have an array of 5 elements. So in case of foreign loop, what will happen is before in the variable that is used before in, I will get 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4. But if I use for of loop, what I will be getting is the actual element that is present there. Now, a point to note here is that why do we use for of loop and where is it useful? See, sometimes what happens is you want the items in the array, but you don't want to accidentally change them. So we use for of loop because it will return the value itself, so that we can be tension free, that we won't be accidentally changing the value in the array. Whereas if we use foreign loop, what will happen is we will get the index and we can assign values to the element at that index by mistake. Maybe it's a very long code inside the for loop and by mistake you use the index and assign some value. That will corrupt your array. So in case you want the array to be untouched and you want to iterate it safely, you are better off using for of loop. Was that clear? A little bit. So, where do you think it was confusing? Maybe I'll share some code with you so that it's much easier. Okay. So you will now be able to see my screen. Are you able to see the JS Fiddle screen? I think you will be able to see the JS Fiddle screen now. You are saying that you have an array of objects. So as you can see now, we have an array where we have two objects. Each object has a key called key, and it has some string value attached to it. Now we'll be writing a for loop. Now see, what we are doing is we got the, in the for of loop, we are saving the current element that we are getting in the variable item right here. And we are providing the array that we want to iterate here. Now what happens is on every iteration, I am alerting with the item dot key. As you can see on the first iteration, I got some value in the alert. That is because the first item that I will get is this object right here. This object, which I'm highlighting, this object is what we will be getting when we are in the first iteration of the loop. In the second iteration, we will get this object. Now I will show you how it is different from for in. If I would do for in that case, this item will be the index. So I will have to use array and square brackets. And I can also show you what item contains. Now I run, you see that item alerts zero because that is the index at which the first item is, the first object is. And when I do array zero dot key, it gives me some value because that is what is stored in that object. The next index we get is one, and when we access that, we get some other value, which is the value stored here. I hope this example has cleared your query regarding for off and for in. If you still have a query, you can write what is causing the confusion, and maybe I'll focus on that point more. Okay, so Nosad has left. Pooja, if you have any more queries. Okay, so I guess we can close this session for today. So I would suggest you guys to keep adding doubts to your list, and you can ask them every day whenever you get this session invite.